We hear it live. And, we have said the announcement we just heard with the
Uri Conger, the husband of a veteran journalist.
The husband of Anna Conger. A veteran journalist, a member of our club. He just passed away. And we send our condolences to
him.
Please turn off your cell phones and switch them to silent mode. I thank our the JPC staff, Linda over there, Maya and Sarah, our able intern, who's doing the live broadcast for YouTube. And we're very pleased this morning to host Dr. Alon Liel. Dr. Alon Liel, former Director General of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Chairman of the Israel-Syria Peace Society in the past, you know, when there was Syria. There was peace, and he held numerous posts, significant posts at the diplomatic corps, including the ambassador in South Africa, the diplomat in Turkey, consul general in Atlanta, author of several books on Turkey, Israel, South Africa, and more. So the issue today, of course, is recent events in Turkey, analysis and the implications for Israel. We usually appreciate a short introduction and then we engage in a Q&A. So, Dr. Liel, please.
Good morning. So, you gave me 10 minutes.
No, I'll give you 15.
I'll use the watch. And you're a journalist, so I'm not here to give you information. You follow. I'll try to the best of my ability to analyze what happened, starting with the motivations. As far as I can see from here, the motivations of this failed attempt, and the rest of the time I'll use for how do I see the developments from here on. Because I cannot stand up. I'll speak up, but you can come closer. There is a chair here. Okay.
Let's take a technical break and I started saying,
try to analyze what's going on. What I think will go from now on as the result of the coup, at least in the first few months, the months coming ahead. So first about the motivations. There were in fact three groups that in the last few years were a strong opposition to Erdogan, the Kemalists, secular people, the Kurds and the Golanists. From everything that happened since this coup started, we didn't hear anything about the Kurds. And it seems as if the Kurds are not part of it, because if it would be the Kurds involved, then we would see most of the things happening in the southeast of Turkey where they are. Where they have the majority, and there was nothing special there, and you know that the focus was elsewhere. So it leaves us with the Kemalists and the Gulenists. Now, I don't know how much time do I have to explain what Kemalists are and Gulenists, but I think that here there is no much need to explain. The Kemalists are the Ataturk supporters, the supporters of this concept that Turkey is secular, a secular state, a pro-Western state, a modern state, And these guys ruled the country until the 3rd of November 2002 for almost 75 years since the Republic was established. Many of them see Erdogan as the guy who not only stole the country, stole the soul, or the soul of the country. The army was considered the machine to secularize or Kemalize the country, so the army was definitely Kemalist. By the way, in the past, before Erdogan came to power, when generals in the army suspected that an officer or even a soldier was trying to convince his friends to go to the mosque, they just put him on the list and the guy was out of the army. So the army was very, very secular until at least 2002. Gulenists. What are the Gulenists? Gulenists are the supporters of Fethullah Gulen. Fethullah Gulen is sitting in the United States since 1999, so it's 17 years already, in Pennsylvania, quite isolated, doesn't leave his home, I think, for years now. Left Turkey, Erdogan tried to convince the Americans to extradite him several times, but as far as I understand, there was no official extradition request, was material or something like this. The Americans like him very much. He's considered a leader of a very moderate type of Islam. And maybe a minute about Gulen, because maybe you will have questions about it. But Gulen is an imam that about 40 years ago decided that the problem with Turkey is that the religious people are not preparing themselves education-wise to modern life, and modernized the education system of Turkey, established about 1,000 schools inside Turkey, also 1,000 outside, in which he installed studies like chemistry, biology, mathematics, English, and in fact, Erdogan owes him a lot because first of all, he supported Erdogan for when Erdogan won the election and for about a decade. And when Erdogan came to power, November 2002, he had the cadres. The Gulenists were already having the university degrees. There were lawyers, there were economists, and there were the guys who were injected into the bureaucracy, the new bureaucracy of Turkey. 3 years ago, I think maybe less, 2.5 years ago, the Gulenists were accused, senior Gulenists in the Ministry of Education and in the police were accused of exposing a corruption in Erdogan and his camp, and since then they are rivals, mega rivals, and crashed the movement inside Turkey to the point that many of them left the country. And I will be glad to elaborate. But I know many, many Kemalists, and I know many, many Gulenists, and I never met a Kemalist that is a Gulenist or a Gulenist that is a Kemalist. This is mutually exclusive. You cannot be a follower of Gulen, an Islamist, an Imam, and believe in secular. Secularism, and you cannot be a follower of Ataturk and believe in Gulen. So, hard for me to understand or believe how these two movements can act together in a coup. So, the question remains, who are the real leaders of this coup? Are they secularists or are they Gulenists? In other words, if the motivation was an ideological motivation, or if it's a power struggle inside Turkish Islam. These are the first 5 minutes in order to speak about motivations. Now, what's happening from now on? Erdogan is not really going to, on the merit, investigate. He already decided who is the responsible figure for any setting. It's tout la plus. So if there were army officers that, by the way, we all see as Kemalists, he kind of captured the mind and so on. So he accuses Gulen. And I don't think that we'll have a situation in a month that Erdogan will stand up and say, we investigated and we were wrong. We were wrong. It's not Gulen, it's these generals. I think he has it on his mind. He probably believes it's Gulen. And from here we have to see what the implications are. He will chase the movement. He already did, as far as I know, hundreds of the senior Gulenists left the country before the coup. Before the coup was spread all over the world. And in fact, I think that the process has already started. That Gulenism is not anymore a Turkish movement. Gulenism is an Islamic type of Islam, another type of Islam, moderate, modern, but it's not anymore a Turkish movement. And I think that the Gulenists themselves, including Fethullah Gulen, came up on being a Turkish movement, and he will continue to sideline them and to evacuate them from any position. If there were Kemalist elements, and you see generals in jail, you see the former commander of the Air Force until a year ago, and they are in jail, I don't think Erdogan is going to point at them and say this was a Kemalist coup. And I think also for opportunistic reasons, the Kemalists are 20% of the population, but they are still the Turkish elite in business, industry, academia. To war with them is very complicated. Easier to war with Gulen, who's already crashed. Again, I'm speculating because Erdogan has now the information. He investigates the people. He can see where they studied at school. Very easy to find out about every Turkish guy, especially if he was in the army. Who are his friends? Who is his family? And if you're a Gulenist, usually people know it's not something that is written on your forehead, but people know who is a Gulenist, and he will have a lot of information. Now I'm going to, in the rest of the 2 minutes Ori gave me.
No, please. Wait, take some more.
Give me the two really, really interesting issues will be now that have international implications. Will be the extradition request and the capital punishment. These are going to be two very important tests. Here it's not only an internal matter, it's an international extradition. First, extradition. The Americans will do everything they can not to extradite Fethullah Gulen. If you Google Fethullah Gulen, you see that in the 17 years that he's in the United States, he became a very popular figure in the United States. A kind of a Martin Luther King, an Islamic Martin Luther King. Look at the list of prizes he received in the United States. This peace prize and another peace prize. And to extradite Fethullah Gulen for the Americans, it will be very difficult. Also, he's 75 years old. And once there was a program of 60 Minutes about him, and they interviewed him, and he forgot to remove the medicines on the table and they filmed the medicine. So you know all the diseases he's having, and he has a lot. And so he's a sick guy, he's 75 years old. To put him on the plane and to send him to the answer, Erdogan will be very difficult. In order for him to get him, for Erdogan to get him, he will have to come with an extradition request that has a lot of information tying these generals to Pennsylvania and proving that Fethullah Gulen was giving the orders. Hard for me to believe that, that such information exists, because this guy is in the last decade working with a small group of American Turks who's around him, and to think that he gave the orders to capture the bridge or the airport or the hotel in Marmaris from Pennsylvania looks strange for me. But if you will have this type of evidence, complete evidence, the Americans will have a real problem. If they have sitting in Pennsylvania a guy that is responsible to the test in so far 290 people, this is something. Then they will have a problem there. So this is the extradition. Capital punishment is another big, big thing. Capital punishment was removed from Turkish law in July 2002, before Erdogan. And half a year before Erdogan came to power. The reason, they wanted to go into the EU. And you cannot be a member of the European Union if you have capital punishment. And they removed it, and he kept it. Now, in 2005, they received the status of a candidate for full membership in the EU. Status that is launching this dialogue gives you certain rights in the contact with the EU, and are still on this status of candidates to membership. Now, if they install again capital punishment, automatically they will stop being candidates to the EU. Today, it's not such a big thing to be a candidate, but still I think Erdogan would like to break the links with Europe. And it's a huge thing. It's a huge thing. Also, if he now has a parliament resolution for capital punishment, it'll be more difficult for the Americans to extradite them, and impossible for the Europeans to extradite the people who ask for Europe. There are 8 guys in Greece now, but many of the colonists are in Europe. Many of the colonists are no EU member. And now the 27 after the no EU member will extradite anyone to Turkey if they're capital punishment. So he will have to do all these calculations. Maybe a word about Israel. By the way, also about Israel, we just signed within this agreement. It was kind of initialed because he has to remove the legal claims against our 4 generals. And it takes time. He has to do it full and law. And then he has to go to court. The families have to go to court and pull the legal claims. It might take time. I don't know if this is what Turkey is going to deal with now. Maybe not. Maybe it will follow the process. But on top of it, if he will bring capital punishment back and start hanging people, start hanging generals. By the way, as you all read, you know that the top general was here in Israel 3 years, the military attaché, and has many Israeli friends, of course. If he will start hanging them, it will be difficult for us also to hug him and kiss him. This is how I see it. I don't know what the ministry is planning to do. The thing that should be the climax of the rapprochement, this reconciliation with Turkey, is the exchange of ambassadors. What I hope is that this will not be delayed too much, because in this crazy area, things are happening very fast, and if we wait 6 months or a year, maybe other circumstances will be around, it'd be difficult to exchange ambassadors. But if you're interested in it, I can tell you what I would do at this moment. It's not important.
No, why don't you tell us what?
Well, first of all, I saw that Israeli officials already spoke to the relevant Turkish officials. Usually there is one guy, his name is Ferdinand Sinarino. He was the ambassador here for years, and he was the official, he's a deputy minister of foreign affairs, and he's usually the guy. He's on his way to New York to be the ambassador in the UN. And I don't know what happened in the talks before, but what I would suggest is to tell the Turkish government, we understand that first you have other issues at the moment too. We also understand and read, even if we don't like it very much, that you don't have a legal system at the moment. This should be said very diplomatically, because if it will take time, let's change the order of things. It's a gesture, it'll be difficult to do, but let's exchange ambassadors and do the removal of the legal claims and the compensation to $21 million. Let's do the removal of the claims and the compensation at a later stage. But I don't know if anyone in Israel has it on his word, but let's give them some ideas.
You should call them right away.
Okay, this I use.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Let's open up for Q&A. Yes, please.
Yes, the coup was put down very quickly.
Sorry.
The coup, yes. The attempted coup was put down very quickly, which suggests that it wasn't very well organized. The first point. And second, is there any suggestion that the claims of a false flag operation are correct?
The conspiracy theory.
Repeat the question. You mean let's say repeat the question.
Yeah.
So repeat. So the first was, the coup wasn't organized properly.
Yes.
The second one?
Is there been a suggestion of a false flag, that it was a false flag operation?
Yeah, conspiracy.
Yeah.
So let's start with the second one, with the conspiracy. If you don't understand what the claim means, then it means that Erdogan did it. That Erdogan did it in order to crack down on the opposition and millions of them believe it. Millions of them. But from my experience, humble experience, I can tell you that I never knew a nation that has a more developed imagination than the Turks. I remember reading books that Atatürk was Jewish, that Demirel was Jewish, and I'm sure somebody is writing now a book that Erdogan is also Jewish. And so there are lots of fantasies and so on. I think it's a crazy concept, but I can understand it, because there are millions of Turks that hope that this will succeed. And now they not only see that it has failed, they understand that they have a much stronger Erdogan. And this is very frustrating. And how come this red guy in their eyes has so much luck that now he has more support than the 50% that already supported him? And the wider support stems from the fact that he saved the country from a military coup. And a lot of the liberals do not like a military coup. They hate him, but they don't like the concept that the army will be the old army every 10 years or so has military boost. So I think it's coming from frustrations. I have a lot of students that are now, topologists, and they're much more connected than me to this social media. And they say, what do you mean? It's in the social media. It says social media, there are 80 million Turks. So if 2 million Turks write it, it's big. But what about 78? So, no, I rule it out. I personally, I don't think there could be a guy that could plan such a thing that thousands of soldiers will go to the streets and even shoot people and images of them and believe that he can control this machine. And by the way, if so, he was so sure that the Turkish public would reject it, and that the call, the FaceTime, will bring these hundreds of thousands to the street. I think it's crazy. I think it's crazy. The second thing about this plant, I think it's a very important question. I think the people who organized it, especially the military guys, I think they thought on an army, a Turkish army of 30 years ago, 20 years ago. The Turkish army was, until Erdogan came to power, very homogeneous, very homogeneous, very ideological, and had a kind of a mandate to intervene and save the country whenever there are troubles. Troubles could be anything. Okay. Economy,
governance,
and now, these days are over. These days are over. When Abdullah Gül, he was the first prime minister of Erdogan, and when he received for the first time the list where the army has to fire people, he had 15 names. I think 7 were officers and 8 were just. And he said, "What do you mean to support them? These are our kids. This is our crown." And the chief of staff said, no, that's what's going on. From 1923, we kicked these guys out. So they were kicked out. But then he took these officers and placed them in different ministries. And then the army stopped giving them names. What does it mean? That in the last 14 years, the army became Turkey. It's not an army of the seculars in Turkey. It's Turkey. So in every unit, you have people who support Erdogan and people who are hating. It's not anymore this unified army that if you give them a structure, and we saw it. This is the reason it ended up being only a part of the army. And I, again, on information, you're better than me, but from what I read, when he was in the hotel in Marmara, he got the information that he started. So somebody bought this army, gave it to him. So I think it was not a matter of not planning. They planned a lot. They went to the media, to the television stations, and they went to the right places in Ankara, to the right places, airport, bridge, symbolic. They did a lot of planning. But I think the mistake was that they thought that the army would like it, and they speculated that at least a meaningful part of the public will like it. And at least in the first hours, their public will go to the street. And it didn't happen. It didn't happen. So I think that the mistake was not the technical mistake of sending people here or here. It was a political mistake of wrongly analyzing what Turkey is today and what the army is today.
Also, they thought in terms of coups in the 20th century, when you take a major registration of the national register of TV station, and this is it, to control the media. Now, first of all, you know how many TV stations there are in that. If you took one, there's 15 others.
Sure.
And the second thing, I don't think they estimated enough the value of social media. When with one call from a smartphone, he reached everybody through CNN Turkey. So I think they knew where to set the tax, but they failed in understanding how people respond today to events. Yes, please, yes.
On the issue of extradition from the states of the imam, do you think that everyone is willing to take a gamble with friendship with the United States? And secondly, do you think he can get away with all these mass arrests that he's making? Is he going to be permitted to get away with that?
Also, two questions.
No question. One is I'm repeating from the YouTube. So one is, will Erdogan go all the way in jeopardizing his relations with the state on the issue of extradition of Gulen. And the second is, what is the second?
The mass arrest.
Oh, the mass arrest.
Will he get away with it?
Get away with the mass arrest and maybe get a bunch of it.
So on the first, I think it depends on what will come out from the investigation of the people. If he can tie Gulen physically to this school, if people will admit we got instructions from the top Gulenists, wherever they are, or from Fethullah Gulen himself, and he will have evidence, testimonies of people and so on, I think he will try. If it's just speculations, I think he will not try.
All the judges.
This is the second half of the question of the judges. No, first you asked about the United States. About the United States, I'm saying, if he will have hardcore information tied Fethullah Gulen to the coup, he will go for it, I think. And the Americans will have a real problem. And maybe we'll have to extradite him. But if he will not have this ability to connect Gulen physically to this coup, maybe he will avoid it. He already said several times in statements, extraditing, but this is not an extradition request. So the question is if he will put this book of extradition request in which he hasn't been. I don't know. It depends on what will come from the investigation of the people that he captured. Now, about this mass arrest, I'm looking at the media and I'm so surprised because he was all the time arresting people, all the time chasing and firing and arresting people. Nothing new. He, in the last 3 years, fired and arrested thousands of people before the coup, including judges, mainly journalists. He was all the time doing it. Now, when you ask about the people he has now, many of them, first of all, were involved in the coup, so who will accuse him for not doing that? He caught them in action, but he goes beyond it, of course. And now he has more backing to do it than before.
Because
what did you tell before? What was the excuse before? That the journalist drew a cartoon against him? This is an excuse to arrest him? Or you didn't like the judge? No, he says, I have to see everything to check. And so, first of all, the figure I saw, 2,000 people arrested. A few thousands were definitely involved. This was quite an operation, especially in Accra. But 6,000, if 10,000 thousands already, and he has been in jail already. And now I think the criticism, at least for the short period of time, if it will not release them in 20 years or 10 years, but at least when he investigates, I think he will not have much accusations, not in inside Turkey, and also not internationally. The excuse that he's having, let me investigate, let me see who is who, what happened, who was connected, who knew, and so I think it's not a matter of a situation that he didn't do it until the coup and now he started. No, he did it especially in the last 3 years when he was chasing the Gulenists already. Oh, massively, really thrashing their organization. And the Gulenists were millions, not hundreds of thousands, millions. Some say 2 million, some say 5, 6 million. Many people, and especially in the education system, is trying to question what are the schools with that so he was doing in the last 3 years of the
world. I've just got also two, one very short. You said in the beginning that the Gulenists left before the coup. Did they know? That was my first question. And the second one is I'd like you to say something. Turkey, because I believe that we surrendered our pride and capitulated the honor of our soldiers who went to the and each other went really genuine in wanting to have some kind of attachment.
We want to repeat
what we have.
Okay. So, just I didn't say they left before the coup. I said they left in the last year.
Ah, the last year. Okay.
Because this, the life of these people became unbearable. Really, he was really cracking down on the movement of the educators, on people who were involved in all kinds of NGOs related to the colonies and so on. So, so the supporters of Güler felt terrible in Turkey in the last year. They were under a lot of pressure. I don't know if they were on the verge of being arrested or not, but many of them fled the country, mostly to Europe. Not necessarily the days before, you know, the whole year or two. By the way, this is a movement that is an international movement in the last 20 years. There are about 1,000 schools in Turkey, but I think over 1,000 schools outside, so a lot of the movement is already outside. And in many cases, especially after what happened now, this is becoming an international movement. They have enough infrastructure outside, and I don't know how able it will be to chase them outside of Turkey. But if they announce we stop to be a Turkish movement, leave us alone, we will not have a good excuse to go and chase them. About this,
you want the short straw in these negotiations. Join the short straw.
The question slash allegation statement is that Israel did a bad deal with this agreement with Turkey.
Okay,
we lost our
priority. This is so we're moving to the second question. First of all, nothing changed. I mean, we signed the agreement with Israel, and he's in power, and even stronger than before. So there is not a question if the agreement holds. The agreement should hold because the two sides that signed it are safely in power. And your question is what if we
should have,
if we should have signed. If we should have signed.
We gave him $20 million, we apologized.
Look, the apology was over 3 years ago.
We did the apology just now.
The apology was in March 2013.
Didn't do any good.
Yeah, I know, but it's not the signing. It was done over 3 years ago under the pressure of Obama. You remember Obama physically putting pressure at the airport on the. So we apologized. It was a big question. If we should have apologized or not, neither one was all the time against it. And Netanyahu was also against it. But the Americans insisted and the apology was done. Now I'll come to the agreement. After the apology, the idea was that the agreement would be a month or two afterwards. But the opposition inside, especially in the world, and all kind of other technical difficulties, postponed it for about 3.5 years. And now, on top of the apology, we have the agreement. The agreement has a lot of aspects, a lot of aspects. It's not only the Ravi Bharma, the apology and the issue of the legal claims in Turkey and the issue of the compensation are the Ravi Bharma. Are the Ravi Bharma the, but the agreement that we signed is far beyond the Ravi Bharma. It includes it is upgrading to the level of ambassadors. It should renew the strategic dialogue. It is building hoping to be the friendship. Turkey was a rival. I don't know if to say an enemy state. It was not an enemy state because we had embassies, not ambassadors, not embassies in Iraq. but suppose a fierce struggle of Israel and the ideal to turn things around. Another key factor, as I see, in the Israeli motivation to sign was the gas. The gas. Yeah. In the, I think, during the last year, Netanyahu, Prime Minister, and the Energy Minister, reached the conclusion that we don't have a serious, reliable customer for our gas. For the export, we have a good customer if we will develop any such infrastructure, so we are the number one customer. But for the export, because Egypt had new discoveries of gas and all other economic difficulties that Egypt is having, and the Jordanians and the Palestinians are very small customers, and even in Jordan there is a small opposition to a deal with Israel and so on. I think the Israeli leadership reached the conclusion that if we will not export the gas of Lebanon, to Turkey, we'll probably not export gas. And I think this was part of the motivation there.
You're not convinced.
No, too short on this. First of all, the agreement that Hamas is still operating in Turkey, we wanted them out, they're still there. And from Erdogan's point of view, I believe that his motivation was that he was not sure about Russian gas.
Let's start first of all. I don't have an intelligence body of my own. I rely on media, and
you're right.
But on this Hamas issue, I think there was an understanding that he's not closing the Hamas office in Istanbul, but he's not allowing this bad guy Abubi to enter Turkey again, and the office was Abubi, as far as I know. Abubi was the figurehead, and so it was a kind of a compromise. He cannot kick them totally out, but he did not allow this bad guy in. On Gaza, on the siege of Gaza, which was his request to remove the siege, there was also a very interesting diplomatic deal worked out by very clever diplomats, which says, we're not removing the siege, but we're removing the siege when Turkey is concerned. Now we're friends, we signed, from the day we signed, we trust you, that you will not cheat us, you bring what you want, we'll check. You bring it to Ashdod, we will check, kosher, we'll let it in, but only you, the rest of the speech is open. And he agreed. So it was a kind of a deal that was worked out, I think, very cleverly, a compromise, a real compromise, as you do in the diplomacy sometimes.
Yes, please. Let's move.
I'd like to follow on to a point you made earlier about the sort of disconnect, suspicion, animosity that there is between the liberal political opposition in Turkey and the communist elite in the army. And also to
the liberal
political opposition, the disconnect, suspicion, and animosity that exists between the liberal animosity and the communist elite, secular elite in the army, which is completely understandable given their past history. And at the same time, because it's a slightly different scenario than you did, not in the short term, but in the long term for Turkey, given the rampage that Erdogan has gone on since the coup. Now, admittedly, as you said, there's nothing new. He's had mass arrests before. But this is a serious rampage. I mean, this is really stepping up a gear. And wouldn't you think that, perhaps not in the short term, not now, in the next few months, given that everybody's in a state of shock, but the liberal
political opposition and the elite in the army, which still probably remains even though they're keeping their heads down, will come to realize at some point that they basically need each other. They need each other unless they collude, not in a coup, but collude in some proper way. What will they end up with is a very big picture that you are painting up is an authoritarian, populist, Islamic state, another populist Islamic state in Turkey. So I do believe that at one point, these two, I would include this in my opinion, these two factions, which have hated each other for years and years, will have to come eventually to the conclusion that they need each other.
So the question was, contrary to your analysis, that you can be either a communist or a communist.
No,
yeah. become very high. They suddenly become high tech offloaded, and they're a strong economy, industry, and so on. Also, they get character of the nation, of the people, that they very fast go back to them. Look, when they had this year, they had some attacks, this magnitude of this attack. Then there were four of them. Attacks with sometimes more than 100 people here. The following day, you come to Turkey, you go to your fidelity. Also, now look at the wounds of the parliament. In a week, you won't see anything. Back then,
tourism, yes, more.
Tourism is another. As far as I know, 2015, they had close to 50 million tourists. 50 million tourists.
50?
50. 50. 5 close to 50. I think 2014, 2015, were booking somewhere between 45 and 50 million. Now, by the way, Germans and Russians are leaving, but Germans have almost 4 million Turks who are visiting Turks in Germany already. It's like our Jewish tourism. And this would be a blow, because first of all, it's the season. Turkish Airlines was affected. Airports were closed for a while. It would take time because here it's not the Turkish recovery. They had an unbelievable recovery character, but this is the world. To the world, it would take time until a family of seconds go down to the Turkish beaches. And so definitely there will be a law on terrorism, on tourism. But on the other hand, we must understand something. The coup, the fact that the coup failed was not only the ideological support for Erdogan, it was also his economic success. The standard of living in Turkey is climbing all the time. And many people are happy with the daily life, with the routine. And they attribute it to him. And Turkey did well economically. And you know that the world went through a difficult period of time, especially 2008. 2008 was a global economic crisis, and it hardly touched on Turkey, as it hardly touched on us. But look at the last few years in Europe. What's going on in Europe? He has 3 million Syrian refugees, and the economy hardly feels it. And he, until about 2 months ago, for the European stuff, and here today, he did it himself. So there is a strong economy, a real economy, not a fictitious economy. People wake up in the morning, go to the factories, and if you have a routine, it works, and it will recover. So now the routine was broken for 36 hours, basically, but it's only 36 hours before the weekend. Tomorrow is Monday, Turkey comes back to work. So I don't see a big economic implication except the tourism. By the way, even Turkish Airlines, I think, will recover very quickly because they're a huge company, a global company. I think, if somebody
already